Steven Spielberg has won multiple Oscars, DGAs, PGAs, the AFI, BAFTAs, Golden Globes, and Donatello's. He has been honored with a César, the Blue Ribbon in Japan, and has been awarded prizes at the Cannes and Venice Film Festivals. As a director and producer, and then under the banners of Amblin Entertainment and DreamWorks Studios, his films have earned over $15 billion worldwide. All of which begs one question: what accounts for his unparalleled success? Obviously, he is a remarkably gifted storyteller, but that is different from being a gifted film director. For a director, it is as simple and as complex as presenting the story in cinematic terms, visually, tonally, rhythmically. In a word, emotionally. Specifically, that means what you see, what you hear, and when. Just as painters have many colours to their palettes, so too does Spielberg deploy a gallery of techniques and devices, all to draw up deep emotions. Spielberg can do this because he intuitively understands image and sound, and the positioning of and interplay between both. Like all masters, Spielberg has observed and absorbed lessons from others. For example, John Ford's The Searchers. As well as Victor Fleming's Gone with the Wind. And of course, the works of David Lean. But Spielberg's innate gifts ensure that what he delivers is never mere imitation. Like all masters, he identifies and is inspired by great moments. He then recodifies those moments, and in so doing, he enhances cinema's vocabulary and expands its grammar. Spielberg enjoys moving the camera, and oftentimes he moves it as a composer phrases music, or a choreographer arranges a dance. Its movement is punctuated, so each moment brings with it new elements. The characters may deliver dialogue, but Spielberg looks to present other information in a visual manner. Call it orchestration or composition, but either way, Spielberg's camera does not so much observe the scene as interact with and gather its details.
Look at the waistline bulge on that guy. Look at that. Think he might be armed, eh?
There's all the Russians.
It's definitely him. Hussein Abad-al-Shir. His room is next to Israeli newlyweds.
In these shots, the pronounced movements are across the frame. Now, this is not a hard and fast rule, but Spielberg's right-to-left, left-to-right punctuation is predominantly about information. But it is different when pushing into a close-up. Or pulling out to a wide shot.
Please.
Such movement serves as a visual key to the emotional tone of the scene. Your eye notices such movements a lot more readily than lateral moves, so when Spielberg's camera dollies in or pulls away, it is not exclusively to reveal information, but mostly to focus the emotion. This was a move favoured by Michael Curtiz, one of Hollywood's great directors from the late 30s and 40s. And you can link it to John Ford. Ford said that the most interesting landscape is the human face. And when Spielberg dollies into a close-up, he is presenting the face as an emotional map for our reading. Where a poet uses words and a sculptor uses shape, Spielberg visualizes the emotion. While we are looking at the characters, quite often the characters are looking up and away at something else. While their eyes may be filled with wonder or fear, by keeping on the character's face an extra beat, Spielberg withholds the answer to our question, what are they seeing? The answer is, what they see interests us, and so we are linked to what they are feeling. That technique takes a minimum of 3 shots. We see the person, we see what they are looking at, and then we cut back to their face to confirm what they are feeling. But Spielberg sometimes condenses it not to 2, but to 1 shot. With great economy, we see what the character is looking at, we see the feeling on their face, and we feel what they feel. I want to pause in this frame for a moment. For me, it is the most riveting and poetic image in Spielberg's career. When I say poetic, I mean expressive of content. In this scene, Schindler has been approached by Regina Perlman, a Jewish woman, asking him to give her parents work in his factory so that they will be safe. She tells Schindler he is a good man, and yet he walks away from her. Looking out over the factory floor, he sees the Jewish workers he is so ruthlessly exploiting. But as Perlman implores Schindler, it appears that he is not so much looking at his workers as beginning to look at himself. And what does he see? A ghost of a man. But look closely and you will also see a flame flickering about his heart. Perlman's visit kindles a spirit which will not only help save 1,000 Jews, but also deliver Schindler from himself. Such poetry is present right across Spielberg's work, and proof that he expands and extends cinema's vocabulary and grammar. Another device Spielberg uses is shadow. With all his interest in the human face, using the shadow allows Spielberg to suggest the human form without necessarily showing it. It can be comic, and it can be horrific. But either way, it is always cinematic. Another technique Spielberg enjoys is taking an item in a scene and making it the object of our attention. It serves as a visual dynamo because while the object itself is inanimate, the characters focus on it, thus giving it importance. They move it, exchange it, and in so doing, the object forwards the scene. Sometimes it is important, while other times, Spielberg is only teasing because in the overall, it is as distracting as Hitchcock's MacGuffin. He also likes circles, and this is a very important device because it diffuses the rectangular shape of the screen. All angles are sharp and severe, but the circle softens them and also offers a different pattern for us to read. The aggregate of all these devices I've listed provide visual motifs akin to that of a rhyming scheme you find in poetry. And that is not to mention the spiritual and religious aspects of his work. You have Moses coming down from the mountain. You have St. Paul on the road to Damascus. You have the shepherd going after the lost lamb.
Find them. Get them home.
You have prophets tormented by visions of the future.
Is it now?
You have a modern-day Moses leading people to salvation.
These are mine! These are my workers! They should be on my train!
You have entire peoples crying out for emancipation.
Give us free.
You've got Indiana Jones.
The quest for the Grail is not archaeology. It's a race against evil.
And most explicitly of all, you have a miracle worker. But what I find most remarkable about Spielberg is that the elements of his creativity, the evidence of his talent, was right there from the start. Before he made his first feature film in 1974, he had worked in television, and although he was then merely a gun for hire, despite the immense creative restrictions, he still managed to present moments that resonated on an emotional level. These are clips from his 1971 TV movie, Duel. And this is an episode called Eyes from the TV series Night Gallery, which he directed in 1969.
I told you all men had a price. That's because all men have something to hide. And you, Doctor, you have more than most. All there, I believe. Do you recall the young woman? Miss Grace Ridden, age 22, who died on a kitchen table because the abortionist had the hygienic habits of a pig and the surgical deftness of a paper hanger. I want to see something. Trees, concrete, buildings, grass, airplanes, color!
So the answer to the question, what accounts for his unparalleled success, is the uniquely cinematic manner in which Spielberg delivers moments of lasting resonance. He does this visually, tonally, and rhythmically. In a word, emotionally.
When you wish upon a star, make no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you.